Hey everyone, I'm JR from Bulls. Welcome back to our series on Avatar Legends, the Avatar The Last Airbender and Legend of Korra RPG, currently on Kickstarter from Magpie Games. Today we're going to be taking a closer look at some of the rules in the quick start and getting a little more in-depth with combat, balance, and character creation. So if you didn't watch our first video, be sure and check that out right around here somewhere. Now, like any good RPG, half the fun in Avatar Legends comes from just making a character, so let's get started and do exactly that. If you watched our first video, you know that the first step to making a character is picking a playbook. Now, there are currently 6 in the Quick Start rules, but they've already unlocked a ton more on the Kickstarter campaign, so there's that to look forward to. But for now, you have the Bold, the Guardian, the Hammer, the Icon, the Idealist, and the Successor. Today, we're gonna make an icon. The icon is a character who's expected to be the exemplar of a tradition, the single most important representative of whatever that sort of tradition or burden might be, like being the Avatar. Now, of course, we need a name for our icon. How about Blang? Blang the Blavatar. As the icon, our base stats are creativity plus 0, focus plus 1, Harmony, plus 1, and Passion, minus 1. We have 1 free point to add to any stat. We're gonna put it in Focus. Now, as part of creating our character, we also have to figure out our balance. So let's take a look at the balance track real quick. As an icon, we're creating a character who's pulled between living up to their role or breaking from tradition and looking for their own personal freedom. We might be, for instance, a young airbending monk who is destined to become the Avatar and stop a horrific war, or we might just want to break free to be a kid and play on air scooters and ride like penguin otters or platypus bears or whatever other animals we can find. Balance represents your character's worldview and how they feel about what their two principles are. For the icon, we start with freedom and role. We can start with our balance shifted one step in either direction. We're going to shift it towards freedom, marking a plus 1 in freedom and subsequently a minus 1 in role. But balance does more than just track your commitment to your principles and how you feel about them. You get to use it for 4 different balance moves which rely on that stat. As an icon, struggle between freedom and role takes the center stage. You can tell by 2 of the traits that are in the playbook, live up to your role or break tradition. Both of these give you a method of clearing fatigue when you either break with tradition or live up to your role in spite of danger. In addition to that, Blang gets to pick from 2 moves. Those moves are use their momentum, which lets us advance an attack with focus instead of passion when fighting a more powerful, larger, or more dangerous enemy. Bonzu Pippin Padalopsicopolis III, which lets us trick an NPC by assuming a silly disguise or fake identity, marking the foolish condition to automatically succeed in our trick attempt as though we had rolled a 12 plus on the dice. Concentration, which is easier to say and gives you just plus 1 focus. Otter Penguins, Unagi, and Hot Springs, which lets us learn information about the local environment anytime we arrive in a new place. And last but not least, my personal favorite, Yip Yip, which gives us a large animal companion to ride around on. We could pick from Flying Bison, Polar Bear Dog, Eel Hound, Cat Gator, Elephant Mandrill, Gemsbok Bull, Shearshu, Komodo Rhino, Sabertooth Moose Lion, Flying Boar, Walrus Yak, Flying Fishopotamus, all of which are real creatures that are in this game. We're gonna go with use their momentum, and because I'm a masochist, Bonzu Pippin Padalopsicopolis III as well. So those are the 2 moves we've picked. Last but not least, we have some questions to answer to finish building the character, and we mark down that we have the Wall of Perfection technique to use in a combat. Speaking of combat, let's fight! Blang gets into a fight with his nemesis, Prince Bluko, like right in the first episode. We just get right to it. This gives us the perfect chance to talk about how combat works in detail. And as a quick note, in Powered by the Apocalypse games, the GM never rolls dice, only the players. As we mentioned in our overview, every combat is a series of exchanges, which are a set of attacks, blocks, dodges, maneuvers, and so on and so forth. As Blang squares off against Prince Bluko, we have to figure out first our approach. Do we defend and maneuver? Advance and attack? Evade and observe? The approach we pick determines when we act and what stat we roll. When you defend and maneuver, you'll roll with focus. For us, a +2. were very dodgy. When you advance an attack, you roll with passion, which normally would be a minus one. When you evade and observe, you roll with creativity or harmony, so we get to decide if we want to add one to the roll or not. Fun fact, the approach you pick is also what determines the initiative order in every combat. In Avatar Legends, defend and maneuver comes first, attack and advance comes second, and evade and observe comes last. Each of these approaches has three basic moves associated with them, and you get to pick from that list when you roll. We're best at defending and maneuvering, so Blang does exactly that. Prince Bluko, surprise, surprise, decides to attack. That means we get to go first, so we roll 2d6. Looks like we got an 8! That means we can use one of the three basic techniques or one mastered technique. Now, let's have a quick aside here. In the quick start rules, every playbook gets one special move. The icons, for instance, is the Wall of Perfection. Those techniques you have to start with are considered to be mastered. Now, over the course of the game, you can learn more special moves that don't do what the three basic moves do, and the full rules will have more information on how you develop your own special moves or how to learn them from masters. Each of these different moves will start off as learned, become practiced, and finally, with the completion of a special quest that might involve some cool storytelling, like finding a meteor to make a sword out of or something, becomes mastered. These three states reflect how easy it is for you to use the technique, and by extension, how much fatigue it costs to use. And remember, every character only has 5 fatigue, so you'll want to use that wisely. Defend and maneuver gives us the option of three basic techniques. Right now, retaliate seems like the best course of action, so anytime a foe, Prince Bluko, inflicts fatigue on us, makes us mark a condition, or tries to shift our balance, I'm gonna talk about that, we get to inflict fatigue on that foe, which we represent fictionally by saying that we move inside his reach, ready to strike anytime he attacks. Bluko, surprise, surprise, attacks and decides to strike, causing us to either mark to fatigue, mark a condition, or shift our balance. We get to pick, though. He could mark an extra fatigue to make the decision himself, but he's leaving the choice up to us, which is very nice. We decide to shift our balance towards freedom, marking it at +2 now. That whole sequence is one exchange. But before we get ready for another exchange, Bluko decides to try something. He decides to use the fact that we're off balance and instead of making another combat maneuver, tries to shift our balance even more. So let's talk in depth about balance. Balance in general comes into play whenever a PC or NPC decides to use their principles or one of four basic balance moves. The four balance moves are resist shifting your balance, which is the move you use whenever you try to resist an NPC shifting your balance, like a senior monk calling on you to live up to your role as the future avatar and stopping a war, demanding that you leave your friends and all your earthly attachments behind to work on your training. When you do this, roll the dice. On a 7+, you get to maintain your current balance in spite of whatever they have said. Do what you want, you either can gain a benefit for proving them wrong, shift your balance towards the opposing principle, or learn what their principle is, which matters because in order to use someone's principle against them, you have to know it. On a 10+, you get to pick two of those options, but on a miss, they know exactly what to say to throw you off balance. There's also live up to your principle. This move lets you mark one fatigue to roll with whatever stat your principle is instead of whatever stat you would normally roll. Like if our icon was trying to push their luck or advance an attack, normally which roll with passion, a -1 for us, we could, if we are living up to our freedom principle, roll with +1 or +2 instead. You can also call someone out to live up to a principle. This is a move that lets you use someone's principle, if you know what it is, against them, calling on them to do what they know is right. But be careful, on a miss, which is a 6-, they might demand that you act in accordance with one of your principles or shift your balance instead. And finally, there's deny a call out, which is the move you make whenever you resist an NPC calling you out. This move is the one time you want to roll low, because on a 7+, you have to do what they say. On a 6-, you get to clear a fatigue, condition, or shift your balance however you want. There's a secret fifth move, but we'll talk about that in a second. For now, Bluko calls out Blang, demanding that he live up to his principle of freedom. We do. We roll to resist this, but unfortunately, we're already at a +2 freedom, and this is the one roll where you want to roll low. Instead, we get a 10. Not only do we have to do what Bluko says, we have to shift our balance, bringing it to a +3 total. Now, we're in danger of losing balance. This is the secret fifth move. When you look at the balance track, you can see it only goes up to +3 in either direction. If something would make you shift past the end of the balance track, instead, you lose your balance. When this happens, you obsess over your principle to an unhealthy degree, which could mean giving in or submitting to the opposition, losing control of yourself in a destructive and harmful way, or taking some extreme action in line with the principle, like freedom, and then fleeing. How that looks is up to you, but it has like a negative implication. Afterwards, after you've had this big like outburst and had a chance to recover and recenter yourself, you can clear all of your conditions and all of your fatigue, so it's kind of cathartic, but now your center is shifted one step closer to whatever principle you lost your balance with. If you look carefully at the balance track, you'll see that there's 5 diamonds in the middle. Each of those represents where your center could be. Normally it would start off in the middle, but if we went off towards freedom, our center from now on basically is +1 freedom, -1 roll. Well, that's Avatar. If you want a refresher on the basic rules, click here. Or for more RPG content, click this playlist right here. I'm JR from Bulls. Thanks for watching. Bye!